might be headed. No matter what you believe or what you may doubt, no matter what you feel, or perhaps you just don't feel anything at all today, no matter whom you love, you are welcome into this space to be met by God, who knows you by name, who knows your heart, who knows your mind, and who wants to have a relationship with you. My name is Cecil Gordon, and I am a member of the Vestry. If you would like communion brought to you in your pew, or if you need assistance of any kind, please let an usher know, and we will be happy to assist you. Today is a special AIMS Sunday, with the second collection supporting the renovation project at Camp Arrowhead. Please stand if you are able for the singing of the opening hymn.
Thank you. Grant that we who celebrate with joy the day of the Lord's resurrection may be raised from the death of sin by your life-giving Spirit, through Jesus Christ our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Amen.
Please be seated for the reading of the Word.
A reading from the Acts of the Apostles. Peter began to speak to Cornelius and the other Gentiles. I truly understand that God shows no partiality, but in every nation, anyone who fears him and does what is right is acceptable to him. You know the message he sent to the people of Israel, preaching peace by Jesus Christ. He is Lord of all. That message spread throughout Judea, beginning in Galilee after the baptism that John announced, how God anointed Jesus of Nazareth with the Holy Spirit and with power, how he went about doing good and healing all who were oppressed by the devil, for God was with him. We are witnesses to all that he did, both in Judea and in Jerusalem. They put him to death by hanging him on a tree. But God raised him on the third day and allowed him to appear, not to all the people, but to us who were chosen by God as witnesses and who ate and drank with him after he rose from the dead. He commanded us to preach to the people and to testify that he is the one ordained by God as judge of the living and the dead. All the prophets testify about him that everyone who believes in him receives forgiveness of sins through his name. Hear what the Spirit is saying to God's people.
Thank you.
from Paul's first letter to the Corinthians. I would remind you, brothers and sisters, of the good news that I proclaim to you, which you in turn receive, and which also you stand, through which also you are being saved, if you hold firmly to the message that I proclaim to you, unless you have come to believe in vain. For I handed on to you as of first importance what I in turn had received, that Christ died for our sins in accordance with the scriptures, and that he was buried, and that he was raised on the third day in accordance with the scriptures, and that he appeared to Cephas, then to the 12. Then he appeared to more than 500 brothers and sisters at one time, most of whom are still alive, though some have died. Then he appeared to James, then to all the apostles. Last of all, as to one untimely born, he appeared also to me. For I am the least of the apostles, unfit to be called an apostle, because I persecuted the church of God. But by the grace of God, I am what I am, and his grace toward me has not been in vain. On the contrary, I worked harder than any of them, though it was not I, but the grace of God that is with me. Whether then it was I or they, so we proclaim, and so you have come to believe. Hear what the Spirit is saying to God's people.
Holy Gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ, according to Mark.
Glory to you, Lord
Sabbath was over. Mary Magdalene and Mary the mother of James and Salome bought spices so that they might go and anoint him. And very early on the first day of the week, when the sun had risen, they went to the tomb. They had been saying to one another, "Who will roll away the stone for us from the entrance to the tomb?" When they looked up, they saw that the stone, which was very large, had already been rolled back. As they entered the tomb, they saw a young man dressed in a white robe, sitting on the right side, and they were alarmed. But he said to them, "Do not be alarmed. You are looking for Jesus of Nazareth, who was crucified. He has been raised. He is not here. Look, there is the place they laid him. But go, tell his disciples and Peter, that he is going ahead of you to Galilee. There you will see him, just as he told you. So they went out and fled from the tomb, for terror and amazement had seized them, and they said nothing to anyone, for they were afraid. The Gospel of the Lord. So they went out and fled from the tomb, for terror and amazement had seized them. And they said nothing to anyone, for they were afraid. I speak to you in the name of the one holy, life-giving, liberating God, Father and Mother to us all. Amen. Alleluia! Christ is risen! Hallelujah. Ah, that's wonderful to hear. Well, good morning, everyone.
Good morning.
And happy Easter. What a blessed day. Though I have to admit, I don't know that I can breathe with all the pollen and the flowers. What a beautiful morning this is for us to celebrate the holiest day of the church year together. And what better way to do it than to welcome new disciples of Christ into the household of God through baptism today. Can I get an amen?
Amen.
Amen. All right. Now today is, I think, the most joyful day of the year. And of course, we are surrounded by these beautiful flowers. Everyone, I'm looking at all of y'all in your finest clothes. Y'all look beautiful. Just everywhere we turn is joy, beauty, and celebration. I gotta say, as our first Easter together, it's just a tremendous joy to be here with you this morning and experience this day together. Can I get an amen to that? Amen. But here's the thing. First Easter wasn't like that at all. And the account from Mark's Gospel this morning that we hear, I think, displays that stark reality. What we hear today begins as a scene of grief and mourning with these three faithful women. They come to Jesus' tomb so that they might anoint him and tend to his body. That's a sacred moment. And the few words that are recorded resonate with those who experience deep grief, don't they? Who will roll away the stone for us, they ask. But their commitment to Jesus move them to go to his tomb, even if their hearts and their spirits might not have really been there yet and ready to do that. But they were going to do it anyway. So if we were there that first Easter morning, we would have seen those three grief-stricken women instead of all the flowers and the beautiful clothes and joys that we share today. But we would have seen those faithful witnesses showing up despite their immense grief. You see, these are the women that never abandoned Jesus before his death. And here they are yet again. Yes, they grieve and they mourn, but they remain committed to caring for Jesus even after his death, just like they remained at his side during those tough times of the crucifixion, and despite all the dangers that were really present for them to be there. I just want to make one note about the text as part of Mark's Gospel. You recall, we've talked about Mark as probably the earliest of the Gospels written down,
And this is the earliest resurrection story, therefore, in those Gospels. And if you turn to the end of this book in our modern Bible, you'll see there are a bunch of additional verses. But the oldest manuscripts that we have stop right here, what we heard today. This is the oldest version of the resurrection story. And those other verses, not to discount them, but they weren't part of the original story. They were likely added later by scribes and others who appear to have really struggled with how do we understand such an abrupt ending to the story without any sightings of the resurrected Jesus or his ascension or anything more than this empty tomb and this young man dressed in white. But the beauty of this resurrection story, I think, is found in its brevity. Because it's the story, I think, of his most faithful disciples. And it encapsulates concisely how we might live out our own Christian witness by following their example. Mary Magdalene, Mary the mother of James, and Salome, a model of faithfulness that I think can be a pattern of discipleship for us. They show up. They care for each other and for others. And then they go and they tell the world about how we might all find life-giving liberation in Jesus Christ and what that just might mean for the whole world. You see, friends, they were the first bold witnesses to the gospel. And as we explore what it means for us to be bold witnesses for the gospel in our own time, I pray that we can pattern our lives after theirs, because they faithfully showed up even when it was hard, even when it was dangerous, even when they were filled with sorrow and grief. They showed up. And then when they showed up, they come in this position of compassionate care, not only for Jesus and his body, but the whole community too. You know, the text tells us that they bought and prepared spices to anoint his body. It's a sacred ritual. But I think they're also holding this fragile group of Jesus' followers together emotionally. And I bet they were caring for a lot of other needs within that community as well. Because let's be honest, we've seen countless times throughout history and in our own lives where a woman or a group of women have held a community together through the most difficult and challenging times. Amen. Amen. And then they go and they tell the story. They tell the story of Jesus. They tell the story of his life and his ministry, but it's their story as well. And while the text, this is where I'm going to pick on Mark a little bit, where the text says they told no one, I think ultimately they chose a different path. Because let's face it, it's obvious they told the story. They went to the other disciples to spread the news, and they told it widely because we know it now, some 2,000 years later. Amen?
Amen?
Amen. Christianity exists because they told this story. Of that we have no doubt. And so these are the foundational pieces of our faith. Show up. Be representatives of goodness, compassion, and liberation. Compassionately care for each other, for the whole community, but especially for the least of these. And then go and tell those we encounter about the goodness of God, how it's changed our lives, and how the world can be a place full of love, grace, and the mercy of God. And so these most faithful witnesses, these disciples and teachers, these beloved women, they model for us how to live out our faith in their direct actions, but also what they do that Mark didn't bother to write down. See, the young man in the tomb tells them to go and tell the other disciples what they had found, to be the first witnesses to the glory of God. Implicit is to tell the whole world, because the reality is the entirety of the news of the resurrection rested on them. They held that responsibility. They held that honor. Mark says they fled the tomb in terror and amazement and did not tell anyone, but look around. Look around. They told the story of what they found in the tomb. Clearly, they did. But they did more than that. They told the story of not only what they experienced in the tomb, they told the story of how they experienced God in Jesus Christ, the love they experienced. As women in that culture, the equality they experienced with him and through him, the liberation from oppression that they experienced. The story they told was so powerful and so extraordinary that here we sit, 2,000 years later, still unpacking it, word for word, verse for verse. You see, friends, these beloved women, Mary Magdalene, Mary the mother of James, and Salome, they were the first bold witnesses to the resurrection of Jesus Christ. They were the first bold witnesses of the empty tomb because they showed up, because they were the ones that cared for Jesus' physical body and for the wider spiritual body of Christ. And because despite their grief and their terror, they told the story. So friends, today we have a glorious celebration to celebrate Jesus' resurrection. We celebrate the divine revelation that we are liberated not only from sin and death, but from our own proclivity to violence and oppression. We celebrate that the tomb could not hold Jesus Christ. The tomb can never hold the goodness and the love of God. Can I get an amen to that? And we celebrate those first disciples turned apostles, Mary Magdalene, Mary the mother of James, and Salome, particularly on this most holy day when we are going to come in front of that font together and we are going to celebrate new disciples into the body of Christ and commit to helping them grow in their faith. We celebrate these, the first bold witnesses to that gospel. We're going to commit together to passing on their faithful witness by showing up for each other, for providing compassionate care for ourselves and others, and especially the least of these. And we are going to commit to boldly proclaiming the gospel of Jesus Christ to the world, telling of the salvation and the liberation that is to be found in him. Today we celebrate that love will always win, that death will never have the last word, and that together we find liberation from the powers of evil in this world. And dear friends, that is very good news indeed, to which we boldly proclaim, Alleluia, Christ is risen.
The Lord is risen indeed. Alleluia.
Amen. candidate for baptism will now be presented. That's okay. I present a year to receive the sacrament of baptism. I hear. Do you desire to be baptized? The next candidate for baptism will now be presented. Logan, do you desire to be baptized? The next candidate for baptism shall be presented. Jet, do you desire to be baptized? Wonderful. The next candidate for baptism will be presented. Dash, do you desire to be baptized? Wonderful. The next candidate for baptism will now be presented. Zamir, do you desire to be baptized? Wonderful. All right, here we go with the questions for y'all. You ready? Okay. Do you renounce Satan and all the spiritual forces of wickedness that rebel against God? Do you renounce the evil powers of this world which corrupt and destroy the creatures of God? Do you renounce all sinful desires that draw you from the love of God? Do you turn to Jesus Christ and accept him as your Savior? Do you put your whole trust in his grace and truth? Do you promise to love and obey him as your Lord? And now for the congregation. Will you who witness these vows do all in your power to support these persons in their life of Christ?
We will.
Oh, amen. That's wonderful. Let us join with those who are committing themselves to Christ and renew our own baptismal covenant. Do you believe in God the Father?
I believe in God the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth.
Do you believe in Jesus Christ, the Son of God?
I believe in Jesus Christ, the only Son of our Lord. Jesus is conceived by the power of the Holy Spirit and born of the Virgin Mary. He suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified,
Do you believe in God, the Holy Spirit?
I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting.
Will you continue in the apostles' teaching and fellowship, in the breaking of bread and in the prayers?
I will without fail.
Will you persevere in resisting evil, and whenever you fall into sin, repent and return to the Lord? Will you proclaim by word and example the good news of God in Jesus Christ?
I will without fail.
Will you seek and serve Christ in all persons, loving your neighbor as yourself?
I will without fail.
Will you strive for justice and peace among all people and respect the dignity of every human being?
I will without fail.
Let us now pray for these persons who are to receive the sacrament of new birth. Grant, O Lord, that all who are baptized into the death of Jesus Christ, your Son, may live in the power of his resurrection and look for him to come again in glory, who lives and reigns now and forever. Amen. Amen. Be with you.
Also with you. Let us give thanks to the
Lord our God.
It is right to give
God
thanks and praise.
Thank you, Almighty God, for the gift of water. What were the Holy Spirit moved in the beginning of creation, through which you led the children of Israel out of their bondage into the land of promise. Getting your son Jesus received the baptism of John and was anointed by the
Holy Spirit as the Messiah. Through his death and resurrection.
In bondage of sin into everlasting life. We thank you, Father, for the water of baptism. In it we are buried
with Christ in his death. By it we share in his resurrection. Through it we are reborn by the Holy Spirit. Therefore, in joyful obedience to your Son, we bring into this fellowship those who come to him in faith, baptizing them in the name of the Father. By the power of the Holy Spirit, that those who here are cleansed from sin and born again may continue forever in the risen life of Jesus Christ. To you and to the Holy Spirit, glory, now and forever. Baptize you in the Holy Spirit. I hear of Christ, may it beacon of light in your life. Look next. All right. Here, let's put that out of the way. There we go. Look, baptize you then. And of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. you are sealed by the Spirit in baptism and marked as Christ's own forever. Amen. We can receive the light of Christ. May it always be a big light in your life. Amen. You ready, Jed? All right, here we go. Jed, I baptize you in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. Jed, you are sealed by the Spirit in baptism and marked as Christ's own forever. Amen. Jed, receive the light of Christ. May it always be a beacon of light in your life. Amen. Dash, you ready? All right. This is a joyful occasion, amen? All right. Dash, I baptize you in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Dash, you are sealed by the Holy Spirit in baptism and marked as Christ's own forever. Whoa. We're not done yet. There you go. Dash, receive the light of Christ. Always be a beacon of light in your life. Amen. You ready, Samir? All right. You won't need... Samir, I baptize you in the name of the Father, the Son, of the Holy Spirit. Samir, sealed by the Holy Spirit and baptism... marked as own. And so may you receive the light of Christ. May it always be a beacon of light in your life. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you that by water and the Holy Spirit bestowed upon this your servants the forgiveness of sin, and have raised them of grace.
Sustain them, O Lord, in the Holy Spirit.
Give them an inquiring and discerning heart, the courage to will and to persevere, a spirit to know and to love you, and the gift of joy and wonder in all your works. Amen. And let us pray together and welcome the newly baptized. We receive you into the household of God, confess the faith of Christ crucified, proclaim his resurrection, and share with us in his eternal priesthood. Now let us give a joyous Sam welcome to the new disciples of Christ. And on this glorious Easter day, the peace of Christ be always with you. Please share now a sign of Christ's love and grace to your neighbor.
Good morning. He is risen.
He is risen indeed.
Amen. Well, if this wasn't enough, we have another baptism next week. And I ask for your prayers for Jackson Corbin. He's the grandson of Brenda Denby, who you know, and the son of Jabrina. We're very excited. As a couple of reminders, the Silent Walk for Justice and Peace leaves from the SAM parking lot this coming Friday at 5:30. I hope that's part of your standing up and getting involved. And I hope you'll consider attending the Compassion Street musical. We're right on the edge of can we have it or not, depending on the number of tickets sold. So look in the weekly vision. And finally, Tino Cruz. He did all the flowers. I just tell him how much, and he does his magic. So thank you. David, please make sure Tino hears it, that we all loved it.
Thank you, D.L. Well, good morning, everyone. Happy Easter, and welcome to SAM on this glorious morning. Welcome to all who are joining us on the live stream as well. It's just so good to be with you today. I have additional announcements. Sorry, I'll try to keep this brief because I know we got a lot in front of us. I want to send out a huge, huge, huge thank you to everyone who made Holy Week and this beautiful Easter celebration possible. I especially want to start with D.L. and David Christopher. You know, when you call a new rector, one of the things that is not talked about is that the rector doesn't know anything about what's come before. And the reality of Holy Week is all of those services are powerful, they're also unique, and they take a lot of planning, for which those two spent countless hours making sure that I knew what I was doing, made sure that everything was planned. And so, for me personally, a huge thank you to both of you. But can we get another round of applause? They are just and I also want to recognize our incredible choir. You know, they sound incredible this morning. They've been here all week, they're just unbelievable. It's such a gift to all of us. Their ministry, as I told them downstairs, their ministry helps us to connect with the divine in such deep and meaningful ways that only music can do that, and they do that for us powerfully all the time. So we are so grateful to all of you. Just a couple of notes as we move into communion. One, wherever you are on your Christian journey, whether this is your first time at SAM, whether you've never been to church before, I want you to know that you are welcome here to receive communion. The body and blood of Jesus Christ, an honored possession, they are God's gift to us. So wherever you are on your journey, please know that you're welcome to receive communion with us this morning. Practically speaking, pretty simple, just follow the crowd as you come up, just fan out on either side. You're welcome to either stand or kneel at the rail and just put your hands out in front of you to receive the bread, and then the chalice will come by afterwards. They'll be gluten-free as well in the center if gluten-free is something you are interested in. If you are interested in coming forward and being part of the celebration, but you're not sure about actually taking the bread and wine, I get that, that's okay too. Just cross your arms over your chest. I'd be happy to provide God's blessing to you, but I want you to know very, very clearly that here at the Episcopal Church of Saints Andrew and Matthew, you are welcome, you are loved, and you are an important part of this community. Let us stand together and say the invitation to the table. Bless you. This is the table.
So come, you who have much faith, and you who have little,
let us with gladness present the offerings and oblations of our life and labor to the Lord.
Thank you.
us give thanks to the Lord our God. Accessible from before time and forever. Fountain of life and source of all goodness, you made all things and filled them with your blessing. You created them to rejoice in the splendor of your radiance. Countless throngs of angels stand before you to serve you night and day. And beholding the glory of your presence, they offer you unceasing praise. Joining with them and giving voice to every creature under heaven, we acclaim you and glorify your name as we sing.
We acclaim you, Holy Lord, glorious in power. Your mighty works reveal your wisdom and love. You formed us in your own image, giving the whole world into our care, so that in obedience to you, our Creator, we might rule and serve all your creatures. When our disobedience took us far from you, you did not abandon us to the power of death. In your mercy, you came to our help, so that in seeking you, we might find you. Again and again, you called us into covenant with you, and through the prophets, you taught us to hope for salvation. Father, you loved the world so much that in the fullness of time, you sent your only Son to be our Savior. Incarnate by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, he lived as one of us, yet without sin. To the poor, he proclaimed the good news of salvation. To prisoners, freedom. To the sorrowful, joy. To fulfill your purpose, he gave himself up to death, and rising from the grave, destroyed death, and made the whole creation new. And that we might live no longer for ourselves, but for him who died and rose for us, he sent the Holy Spirit, his own first gift for those who believe, to complete his work in the world, and to bring fulfillment, the sanctification of all. When the hour had come to be glorified by you, his heavenly Father, having loved his own who were in the world, he loved them to the end. At supper with them, he took bread, and when he had given thanks to you, he broke it, gave it to his disciples, and said, "Take, eat. This is my body which is given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." After supper, he took the cup of wine, and when he had given thanks, he gave it to them and said, "Drink this, all of you.
This is my blood of the new covenant, which is poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Whenever you drink it, do this for the remembrance of me. Father, we now celebrate this memorial of our redemption, recalling Christ's death and his descent among the dead, proclaiming his resurrection and ascension to your right hand, awaiting his coming in glory, and offering to you from the gifts you have given us, this bread and this cup. We praise you and we bless you.
We praise you, we bless you, we give thanks to you. And we pray to you, Lord our God.
Lord, we pray that in your goodness and mercy, your Holy Spirit may descend upon us and upon these gifts, sanctifying them and showing them to be holy gifts for your holy people, the bread of life and the cup of salvation, the body and blood of your Son, Jesus Christ. Grant that all who share this bread and cup may become one body and one spirit, a living sacrifice in Christ to the praise of your name. Remember, Lord, your one holy Catholic and apostolic church, redeemed by the blood of your Christ. Reveal its unity, guard its faith, and preserve it in peace. Remember all who have died in the peace of Christ, and those whose faith is known to you alone. Bring them into the place of eternal joy and light. And grant that we may find our inheritance with the Blessed Virgin Mary, with patriarchs and matriarchs, prophets, apostles, and martyrs, with Blessed Andrew and Matthew and all your saints who have found favor with you in ages past. We praise you in union with them and give you glory through your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord.
Through Christ and with Christ and in Christ, all honor and glory are yours, Almighty God and Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, forever and ever.
Now, as our Savior Christ has taught us, we are bold to say, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. These are the gifts of God.
for the people of God. Take them in remembrance that Christ died for you, and feed on him in your hearts by faith with thanksgiving.
Thank you.
I was expecting more applause. Can we get an amen for that? Amen. Let us pray. Almighty God, may we who share Christ's body may Almighty God, who has redeemed us and made us his children through the resurrection of his Son, our Lord, bestow upon you the riches of his blessing. Amen. Amen. May God, who through the water of baptism has raised us from sin into newness of life, make you holy and worthy to be united with Christ forever.
Amen.
May God, who has brought us out of bondage to sin into true and lasting freedom in the Redeemer, bring you to your eternal inheritance.
Amen.
And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be among you now and remain with you always.
Amen.
Yeah.
Let us go forth into the world rejoicing in the power of the Spirit. Alleluia. Alleluia.